Now, I've discussed personal biases a number of times on this channel, from the way that alternate historians are very slow to discard their pet hypotheses, even in the face of overwhelming evidence against them, to the penchant that many historians, debunkers, and scientists have to just throw out the baby with the bathwater. Nothing to see here. This is something I've talked about at length, and it's something I'm going to continue to talk about because right now we've got a great example of this happening in our community, thanks to the words of Jimmy Corsetti and the reaction by the archaeological community. He talked about the trees on Gobekli Tepe, among other things, but in particular what I want to focus on is the trees. There are olive trees planted on Gobekli Tepe. Jimmy mentioned those, and archaeologists responded in a manner that we have now quite the debate going on. We have the alternate history types going, why can't we dig there? What's the conspiracy? What are you guys trying to hide from the past? And we have the historians and archaeologists and debunkers saying, look, man, there's nothing to see here. We plant olive trees over these kinds of sites all the time. This is normal stuff. Well, this is kind of interesting because we've seen a lot of opinions thrown around and very, very little actual data is concerning this whole thing here. There is data on this kind of thing. Surprisingly enough, people have just thought about these kinds of things before. Trees damaging infrastructure and foundations and archaeological sites. This isn't the first time this has come up. So let's go ahead and take a look at standards around the world. What kind of things we can expect from these trees in specific, particular, or however you want to say that, because I'm good with words. And then, I guess, we could also take a look at the specific circumstances that are present at Gobekli Tepe, and see how that might change things that are the standards around the world. Hi, my name is Dan, and welcome to Dedunking. Now, for the few that are unaware, Gobekli Tepe is a site in Turkey that is about 12,000 years old, one of the oldest megalithic sites on the planet. It's really famous for overturning kind of an old paradigm of how we believed that humans had to progress. It used to be believed that humans had to have farming going on, and once we domesticated food and we had a surplus of food by plant domestication or animal domestication or a combination of both, we would be able to like spend a surplus of labor then building cities and places like Gobekli Tepe. But Gobekli Tepe shows up at the same time as farming basically just begins. There's no real domesticated foods at the beginning of the Gobekli Tepe being used. So it kind of threw everything on its ear, and it put scientists and archaeologists and anthropologists in a different foot trying to explain how their old model might not be entirely accurate. Now, the place was originally excavated, it started to be excavated in the 90s by a German archaeologist, Klaus Schmidt, and it's now been taken over by Lee Clare, who is a Turkish archaeologist. And he's really been more focused on a lot of the political side of it. Turkey is not exactly a stable place. Like most places in the world, it's got its own little personal issues that we're going to discuss in a little bit more detail, but he's been quite a bit focused on that, and so it's no surprise that he is almost unawares of this whole debate that's going on here. But not anymore. He's up to speed now. Anyway, this is the reason that we're having this whole discussion, is because of the way that this site is being questioned, because Jimmy brought up the trees, and the response to it has been like, phew. Now, the immediate reason that you'll hear from most archaeologists and debunkers is these trees were planted to stop topsoil erosion to preserve the site. Now, there's two things worth mentioning. The first is, that's not really accurate. This is basically evidence that this is, the person you're talking to is kind of knee-jerking, because if you look into this a little bit, you'll quickly see that that's not exactly the right answer. Kind of not even at all the right answer. But if you are going to discuss the whole erosion thing, if we're going to look into that side of it for the second point, we'll go ahead and do that. Now, as you'll no doubt be aware, roots are used to, like, stop erosion, to stop soil from running down the hills when the water comes. For archaeological sites, generally speaking, they prefer native grasses. I know it's crazy, right? But for a couple of reasons. One, the roots are less intrusive, but still do the job of bonding the soil. I mean, the hill on Gobekli Tepe has been there for, like, 10,000 years, right? The grass has done just a fine job of holding it together that long. But the other reason is, grass roots tend to be less intrusive. And if they're the native ones, well, they're going to bring the native wildlife and microbial stuff that comes with it, right? I mean, there's a whole freaking ecosystem that comes with these plant roots and stuff. It's not just olive tree roots that shoot into the ground and nothing else happens. There's all kinds of shit that accompanies that, that changes the soil chemistry. And archaeologists and geologists, all these people, they're well aware of this shit. But it's a trade-off, all right? You can't. There is no perfect solution for saying, no, we're going to preserve this site. We'll just dig it all up and hermetically seal it. There's no perfect solution that way, and there's no perfect solution to stopping erosion. However, it is very important to note, generally speaking, they prefer native grasses. That's the deal, okay? Right off the bat. It's also important to note that tree roots don't tend to grow the manner that we normally think of them growing. Anytime I read the literature on this stuff, immediately I'm presented with this picture here where it shows the tree roots quite a bit different than we would normally think of them. Basically, they're a lot wider than they are deeper. That's a very important thing to keep in mind as we go forward as well. For example, the UK Forestry Service has this to say on it. Although few roots extend beyond 1 to 1.5 meters in depth, archaeological evidence commonly occurs within this soil thickness, and where important remains are known to exist close to the soil surface, tree planting is not recommended. So for a site like Gobekli Tepe, where there is numerous layers of occupation, it's probably a good idea to stick with grass instead of trees, right? But why do they use trees for that? Well, okay, you're going to hear all these guys say, oh, they were planted to stop erosion, but again, that's a knee-jerk reaction, the one that shows that they haven't done any research into this at all. They're just using this to argue because they think that Jimmy's wrong, okay? Something that I've talked about before. People, when they think the other guy's wrong, they just knee-jerk and just start running at it without even looking under the hood. They just assume, how could they possibly be dumber than that guy, right? Well, you are. You're way dumber because the stuff that you said was just plain wrong. Let's let the Prehistory Guy channel talk about it. And Rufus Sulskin, I believe his name is. Rupert Sulskin. Man, I'm bad with names.
So there's another biggie that Jimmy talks about. Another feature he talks about in a very conspiratorial way is what he describes as orchards of trees. These are actually olive trees, and they've actually been a massive pain for the archaeologists. Now, the conspiracy theorists will tell you that they are planting trees to stop you from excavating, or some such nonsense. What the conspiracists failed to take into account is that when Gobekli Tepe was discovered, this was all private farmland, and pretty much worthless farmland at that. Now, when it became clear that this was a major discovery, it also became clear that the authorities would want to take ownership of the land to continue the excavations. So the farmers started planting olive trees as fast as they could to increase the value of the land by 10 to 20 times at least. Now,
and this is an important thing to take note of. I do have to disagree with what Jimmy said in the previous video, where he said that there was no way that, you know, planting trees would raise the property value. In normal case, I would agree with him. You know, it's like, this is a freaking UNESCO World Heritage Site. It's kind of priceless. But if you're like a private citizen and you've got this land and it's about to get bought out from under you by the federal government and you got no ifs, ands, or buts, no way to stop it, they're going to have a prescribed, like, freaking formula. And developed land with trees on it's going to be worth more than undeveloped land without trees on it. So I understand why they would have started slapping trees up on it really quick. But that's important to know. One thing that's really important to note is these trees were not placed there by some experts in erosion and weathering, and they were not placed there at the behest of any experts at all. They were slapped into the ground to pull a few more bucks out of the government, and that's it. So all this talk of, oh, stop and erosion, this is bullshit, okay? This may work to help stop erosion, and we'll discuss that. But put there to stop erosion? Bullshit, okay? Not true. Not true at all. These were not put there to stop erosion. And again, if they were trying to do this, what they would want to do would be to use the native grasses that you see all over the area right there that stopped the hill from sliding off for the last 10,000 years. I'll let some German geologists that were talking about the site in 2019, I'll let them explain. The present-day climatic conditions would allow a vegetation cover that is comparable to the one that existed during the settlement period of Gobekli Tepe. However, past and present land degradation and modern agricultural practices have prevented the development of this potential natural vegetation cover. Animal husbandry, mainly sheep and goat pasture, prohibits the reestablishment of a steppe-like vegetation, especially grasses. Arable farming prohibits the reestablishment of a light steppe forest. Arboriculture, e.g. olive plantations and afforestation, presents the formation of natural steppe. Changes in hydrological system, as most obvious in the Haran-Ovasi and the Kulap-Sulya Basin, in combination with irrigation measures, constitute an entirely human-managed agro-landscape that has nothing in common with conditions that prevailed 100 or 10,000 years ago. Hence, locally, the environmental characteristics around Gobekli Tepe may have changed considerably in the course of the late Pleistocene and Holocene. The degree to which such changes are of importance for the understanding and interpretation of the archaeological site is the objective of future research. Now, this paper, it's more concerned with, like, recreating the old school landscape and whatnot than it is actually, like, protecting the site. So you do have to extrapolate a little bit, but it does tell you that this is a different site now. There's different grasses, and we can't bring it back to the way that it was without doing a few things, including getting rid of those trees. And again, this brings in a whole different soil chemistry. So this does show you that things are quite a bit different than it has been there for a long time. And those trees are certainly part of the problem, no matter what the archaeologists are going to try to tell you. Now, in addition to that whole mess, we have something that anybody with a green thumb has already figured out long ago, the first time they heard of this mess. Roots follow water, and this is a very dry part of the country. Now, imagine if any parts of Gobekli Tepe had a well in it that are underneath those trees. I'll read again from the United Kingdom's Forestry Service. Concerns have been expressed over a tree's ability to seek moisture-retaining deposits under rubble or chalk-cap barrow and invade the important cultural and paleo-environmental horizon. One example of rooting preferences was seen at Boscombe Down, Amesbury, where the Romano-British wells, comprising of several vertical shafts cut into the rock 3 to 4 meters deep, were lined by a root mat several centimeters thick. Now, in this case, the roots were not said to have caused any damage to the wells, but that doesn't mean it would be that way in every case. As a matter of fact, you can pretty much guarantee that if the roots are thick enough, they will damage these things. And another thing that's worth mentioning now is that Gobekli Tepe is kind of being treated as a guinea pig in these regards. We don't really know what to expect from those trees and what's going on underneath them, because we don't know exactly what is underneath them. And now, you know, some people have posited that some of these enclosures were potentially filled with water. Well, what if one of them had a well? Now, that thing is going to be just annihilated with roots at this point. All those tiny rocks in those enclosures just ripped to shit. Big things blown down potentially, torn down potentially. And there's another thing worth mentioning too, all right? Like, roots seek out water. They don't seek out organic material to use for food. Like, if it's short on whatever nutrient, it doesn't go looking for it necessarily in the soil. But if a root encounters an archaeological deposit during normal growth, the extent of proliferation and exploitation will depend on its nutrient and moisture content and how that compares with the surrounding soil. Any water-retaining or nutrient-rich archaeological evidence in a drier or impoverished soil will provide a favorable rooting environment for any plant species. So in that dry-ass part of Turkey where Gobekli Tepe is located, you can be pretty much guaranteed that roots are going to be chowing down on anything that they can get their hands on. But how damaging would olive tree roots specifically be? Well, that depends on who you ask. If you ask the archaeologists that are responding to Jimmy Corsetti, well, you could find things like this. Olive roots are generally horizontal and not considered invasive or damaging to infrastructure. They just don't go deep enough, but they do keep soils from eroding or slumping during rain, snow, or tectonic movements. But as we're about to see, those are the words of somebody with skin in the game, with a narrative to forge and maintain. How about somebody who's just telling you what to do if you're going to plant olive trees around your house? An olive tree, when fully grown, has a large canopy along with an eye-catching gray, twisted, gnarly trunk. Appropriate species bear fruit, olives. However, the roots that allow the olive tree to succeed have attributes that can be a problem. The olive tree, fully grown, reaches heights of 40 feet with a canopy of 15 feet wide. Take into consideration that the roots will extend even further out than the crown of the tree. Planted too close to a structure, the roots can damage the foundation. If an extensive root system develops under a foundation and later dies off, the resulting gaps can cause foundation shifting with interior and exterior problems. The article goes on to discuss potential damage to other infrastructure like plumbing lines and electrical lines and other things underground, and basically tells you to be careful with the roots. All right, these aren't no big deal. Now, these guys there don't know who Jimmy Corsetti is, so that might be the problem here. Maybe archaeologists need to let them know who Jimmy Corsetti is, because this site's just Hunker, I think it's called. It's like some website for feng shui-oriented hippies that want to make sure that their olive trees don't tear out their freaking septic tank. So they go look here, and it tells them the tree or two is problematic roots, so be careful about it. Now, again, if they were told about Jimmy, maybe they would change their attitude. But since they don't know about Jimmy, all they do is give you factual information about the trees, which I would point out, when the archaeologists say, oh, these roots are non-invasive, they don't cause any damage, blah, they are giving you factually incorrect information in their argument against Jimmy, which, as I've said a number of times in the past, if you are going to debunk pseudoscience with more pseudoscience, why are you even bothering? Because at the end of the day, there is no question, olive tree roots do cause damage. Another issue this causes is contamination, and I don't just mean fertilizer chemicals and minerals in the water. I mean full-on organisms. Remember when I talked about Boscombe Down, the place with the wells and a couple of centimeters of root growing into it? There are snails that are found there that they archaeologists know do not show up in the record until after the medieval period, but they're showing up before the medieval period because of these roots. They're almost certain the roots are the reason why. So archaeologists in that site can't use something like these snails that they normally use and say, this is a marker. We know everything before this came before this. They can't use it at that site thanks to these roots. That's just one little minor damage. And now, it's worth mentioning, you hear them all the time be like, oh, well, we're saving this for future generations with better technology, better means, yada, yada. Okay, fine. I'll run with that for a second. You are contaminating that soil with all kinds of freaking chemicals. So you get these guys at 50 years from now, and they've got their little chemical reader that does parts per kajillion, and they're out there shooting the soil like some NCIS guy, and it comes up with Roundup and freaking 28 other half illegal chemicals, because they're still legal over in Turkey, but they're not illegal in Europe and in America. What the hell is that going to do for future generations? If it hasn't eaten through the rocks that are down there to begin with, what good is that going to do? You're corrupting the site so heavily that it's not going to be something that you can bring better tech to bear on in those regards down the road. Maybe better preservation, but we don't know because you haven't experienced this kind of thing before. Now, I guess it's possible if they were like, oh, we're going to record each and every type of fertilizer that we bring through this place since these fields were planted in the 90s. They could do that, but here's the deal. I don't think they're doing that at all. As a matter of fact, this whole thing seems to be done by the seat of its pants. Lee Clare recently was discussing some of this stuff, and he makes it sound pretty clear that this is a very volatile political situation in addition to everything else, and there's a lot of navigating different groups of people going on.
I mean, there's a bit of a long story to these trees. I mean, the trees were actually planted back in 2006, I believe, and mm-hmm. Of course, that was before the site was actually purchased by the Turkish state. And before that, of course, it was farmland. Yeah. And the farmers, they were farming it. And in 2006, they planted these olive trees, which are still there today. They also have another important function. They're actually still a connection for the local population to the site, because mm-hmm. they planted those trees. And of course, you know, the archaeologists, the Turkish state, you know, the tourists, we're not the only stakeholders here. It's the local population as well. They identify with the site very much still today, even though it's no longer in their possession legally. They still have this sort of very much conscious awareness of the site as having belonged to them. And this is another way of their connection. You know, they still go up and harvest the olives, for example.
Ah, that's cool.
They go in and they harvest the grass, for example, for their animals. Yeah, I mean, I see the people that come to visit the site. I mean, we have religious groups, Islamic groups of Muslims, of Christians. We have people singing psalms at the top of the site sometimes. We get people at the wish tree putting their hands on the tree and meditating. We get people looking for ley lines, etc. You know, We have lots of different visitors.
So let's be very clear here. This is not about soil conservation, all right? This is a political thing. And some archaeologists have said that this is an impediment to them being able to dig.
And they've actually been a massive pain for the archaeologists. Now,
So why are the trees being left? Well, I'm not as into conspiracy theories as many are, but I do think in this case that there is a little bit of a conspiracy going on. I think it's a lot of people that are just very emotional that are frustrated with their inability to protect the site properly. They can't protect it from the weather, they can't protect it from the locals, they can't protect it from the trees, they can't protect it from any of it. It just slowly is all falling to hell around them, and there's nothing they can do about it. It's really weird, as a matter of fact, like the archaeologist Lee Clare is kind of excited to get people out there trampling the site into the ground.
And this is another way of their connection. You know, they still go up and harvest the olives, for
Ah,
example.
that's cool.
They go in and they harvest the grass, for example, for their animals.
Now, Lee also mentions that the trees are being carefully monitored and the problematic ones are being removed. But pay close attention to how he says this. Does he say that the trees with roots that are running amok in Gobekli Tepe's ruins are being removed? Or does he say the trees that are in the way from future projects are being removed?
Of course, they do, in a way, help hold the soil, but they're being constantly monitored to make sure that they're not causing damage
Okay.
to the underlying features. And of course, a few have been removed in the course of like the construction of the shelters.
They remove the trees that are in the way of them doing future projects, not the trees that are like damaging the ruins. They don't even know what trees are damaging the ruins. They don't know what's down there. They just have a rough idea. And this is the kind of thing that if it wasn't Jimmy that brought it up, they would be complaining about. They would be saying, man, these tree roots are a freaking problem. But since Jimmy said it, they'll die on the hill of, we don't need to ever know what's going on under those. And let's be clear. The whole idea that a 30-year-old olive garden has some great cultural connection to the locals is absolutely insane. We know these trees were planted about 30 years ago to raise the property value to sell to the Turkish government. So you can't say, oh, these have some great cultural connection to the locals. They remember when their great-great-grandfather sacrificed a goat to make that tree grow better. No, bullshit. It is a tree that freaking some dude younger than me planted. I ain't buying this shit. All right? Ain't buying it for 1 minute, and neither will most people that think that there might be some kind of a conspiracy going on here, which makes this really hilarious because in their this die-hard battle to debunk Jimmy Corsetti, they end up making it look more and more and more conspiratorial. Look, I understand the issues with navigating multiple peoples. I talked about the East Wenatchee Clovis site not too long ago, right? And the Native Americans and the archaeologists battling about over who was going to control the site, and the archaeologists losing and then lamenting the trees being planted over the top of it. But here's the deal. I get that, like, navigating the political side of this and different groups of people having claim to the site, that's not an easy thing. And again, there's no such thing as like a one size fits all. Here's a simple solution. I get that this is a problem. But all you got to do is just say it. Be honest about it. The trees are a problem. Just say it. The trees are a problem. They could potentially damage the site. They shouldn't be there. They were not planted by experts in irrigation reduction or whatever. They were not planted by even professional landscapers. They were planted by people with the intention of raising the property value and done so, presumably, pretty damn quickly. They are not a heirloom or some great cultural touchstone to the region. They are a eyesore, a blight on that area. Geologists and historians and archaeologists would all be in agreement if nobody had knew Jimmy Corsetti was part of the conversation. And don't blame Jimmy for that, by the way. You can if Jimmy weighing in on something makes you so stupid that you can't see the freaking forest for the trees, that's on you, okay? That he says things that I'm not a big fan of either, but it doesn't make me so stupid that I can't like suss out the stuff that he says that makes sense. Not the first time that I pointed out that I don't agree with an alternate history guy, but I do end up thinking that he is providing some value to the whole thing. But again, all you guys have to do is be honest about this. Just own it. Just say, hey, you know what, man? Oops. This is a situation where we wish we could get rid of those damn trees. We wish that we had some sway there, but we don't. We can't stop these things. Instead, you defend the indefensible, and it gets way worse than that. I think it would be okay to rebury Gobekli Tepe and seal the entire site with concrete. After 30 years of archaeological research at the site, there is plenty to keep archaeologists there busy for a long time. Now, not only is this false, because we know there's plenty left to learn from the site, it betrays a really unscientific, combative attitude, a knee-jerk reaction to these things that has the it shows that the only real thought is going into a debate strategy, not into the actual science side of this. And this John Hoops isn't the only guy to do this kind of silly shit. I mean, listen to the way Flint Dibble talks about this at the beginning of his discussion with Lee Clare.
What about the erosion? So another thing that's come up on Twitter lately is kind of these olive trees that have been planted. I mean, from looking at them, I would think that having olive trees planting would help limit erosion. You know, sort of trees trap soil on different sites. I've seen trees there to help limit erosion, provide shade, etc.
Flint doesn't know what he's talking about here. I mean, he does with seeds and ancient food, but he's going to make sure that Lee goes in the right direction when he starts talking about this. Otherwise, you know, we're going to give Jimmy some points. We can't have that. And now this is just getting us nowhere, because let's be very clear here. If that soil does need to have things planted on it to conserve it, shouldn't that stuff be planted by a team of experts that are like in soil conservation and like be maintained by people that are experts in that, and not just planted by people haphazardly trying to raise the property value to sell to the feds, and then turned around and propped up because of a narrative of archaeologists versus pseudo-archaeologists? Doesn't it make more sense that we should put in like the grass that the conservation people say that we should? Like, that's generally speaking what you want to do in a situation like this. So shouldn't that be what we do? Of course that should be what we do. But I think anybody with a brain on their shoulders understands that should be what we do. But that's not what Jimmy's the one that brought this up. And since Jimmy's the one that brought this up, they will rather die on this hill, encase the place in concrete, and treat these 30-year-old olive trees like they're some freaking, like they're more valuable than a 10,000-year-old freaking archaeological site. All to spite Jimmy Corsetti, some fucking guy on YouTube. Scientists are the ones damaging the credibility of science. It's not anybody else doing it.